Next, we're going to have Yangjin Pak, and let me just pull up his talk. Professor Pak is a professor in the Department of Archaeology at Chungnam National University. He received his MA and PhD from the Department of Anthropology here at Harvard. He is currently president of the Society for Korean Bronze Culture, a member of the Archaeological Research in Asia editorial board, and since 2012 has been the president of the Society for East Asian Archaeology, which, for those of you who don't know, we will be having the international conference here at Harvard in June of this year. His recent publication includes investigations at Nohliang in 2001 and leadership in the Hongshan culture, as well as phylogeny of the Korean Bronze Age. He's published extensively on topics related to prehistory and early historic periods in Korea and in particularly in Northeast China, and we're very happy to have him back with us today.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Having come from China just 2 days ago, this is the worst time to present a talk because of the jet lag. And I have this bad flu, and I took medicine right after the lunch. So it made me double drowsy, but I'll try to stay awake during my presentation. Archaeological research in South Korea is now carried out by diverse institutions and personnel. National Museum of Korea, National Research Institute of Cultural Heritage, and their respective branches are major public institutions that conduct research-oriented archaeological surveys and excavations. In addition, there are now about 100 or so cultural heritage institutions which specialize in salvage or CLM archaeology in South Korea. The current law stipulates that an archaeological survey and excavation, if necessary, must be carried out before any type of construction begins in an area over 30,000 square meters. This has led to the explosion of salvage archaeological work in the 2000s and 2010s. Here in this diagram, you can see, for instance, in 2009, there were more than 1,500 salvage archaeological projects nationwide with the total cost of about $500 million. The continuous development of salvage archaeological work has contributed to the big progress in our understanding of prehistoric and historical periods of Korea. In the past few decades, many new important discoveries have been made in prehistoric and early historic archaeology of Korea. These discoveries have filled many chronological and regional gaps in the Paleolithic, Neolithic, and Bronze Age periods, and provided important new clues to early societies of the Three Kingdoms period, which has insufficient and incomplete written records. Some archaeological works also complemented the more recent past of the Goryeo and Joseon dynasties with new evidence of their material culture. Another area of improvement is in the field of underwater archaeology, and with the establishment of National Research Institute of Maritime Cultural Heritage in 2009 and the launch of an excavation vessel, Nurian, in 2012, more systematic excavation research of underwater archaeology is now possible. Since there are so many important archaeological discoveries in the recent years, I would not discuss them at all, except one example, and rather focus more on the recent controversies in South Korean archaeology. The early Holocene site in Gosan-ni, on the eastern coast of Jeju Island, has yielded a number of primitive pottery sets and microlithic tools. These sites present important evidence of transitionary period from the Upper Paleolithic to the Early Neolithic period, filling one of the biggest holes in prehistoric archaeology of Korea. Even after the salvage archaeological excavation for a certain construction project, the conflict of interest between the development and preservation can become a big issue, especially when the presence of an important archaeological site is confirmed. The biggest and yet unresolved such a controversy in recent years has emerged after the plan to build a Legoland theme park on the island of Jungdo in Chuncheon, Gangwon Province, was announced in 2011. And the following salvage archaeological work has discovered the evidence of continuous occupation of the island during the Neolithic Age, Bronze Age, and Proto-Three Kingdoms period. The whole island is being excavated. The joint excavation of an area of 443,000 square meters by five institutions have uncovered 185 pit houses and 40 dolmens of the Bronze Age, 37 houses, two burials, and agricultural fields of the Proto-Three Kingdoms period, and Three Kingdom period burial with a golden earring in the Goguryeo style. Some insist the complete preservation of the whole site and an abandonment of the Legoland project, but the investment companies who have already paid for the excavation cost, as well as the local government, who welcomed the input of US $100 million in the local economy, are lobbying for the quick wrap-up of the archaeological work and the construction of the Legoland Korea as soon as possible. More excavation is necessary in other areas of the island, and the final decision for the future of this site and the Legoland project will be ultimately made by Cultural Heritage Administration and its Cultural Heritage Committee, although it is expected to reach some kind of compromise after the completion of the excavation. Another controversy is emerging not because of the private development, but because of the government's initiative to excavate a national historic site and to make use of it as a tourist destination. Walsung, or Moon Fortress, is a very well-preserved archaeological site located in the capital city of Silla Kingdom in Gyeongju, since it was designated as a national historic site in 1963. A number of small-scale excavations had given a valuable information for the nature of this structure of an area of 300,000 square meters. It is quite possible that this fortress was the location of the Silla palatial structures, and such interpretation is well supported by a series of the non-destructive geophysical surveys. However, the full-scale excavation began in 2014 after the lobby of the local government for the full reconstruction of the palatial buildings on the site. Many archaeologists and conservationists are against the excavation of site as there is no threat of destruction and there is very little new information to learn from this destructive excavation. This project reminds some scholars of the decision by the late President Park Chung-hee to excavate the largest Silla royal tomb to demonstrate the cultural achievement of Silla right after the accidental discovery of the undisturbed tomb of Paekje King of Munyeong and its extraordinary burial goods in 1971. Political agenda and local interests still play a major role in the decision to excavate a perfectly preserved site in his daughter's current administration. I mentioned earlier the explosion of field archaeology in the 21st century in South Korea, which laid foundation for the further development of Korean archaeology. But there are some ill effects as well on the discipline of archaeology in general and archaeological education in particular. Even though there are more than 1,000 archaeological excavation projects every year, the majority of them are related to the salvage or CLM archaeology, and most university museums and institutions are not allowed to participate in the salvage archaeology by the Cultural Heritage Administration. CHE insists that the university institutions should focus more on the research-oriented excavations, but in reality, it is quite difficult for a university institution to find financial resources to fund such an excavation. That's why there are so few number of research-oriented archaeological projects in recent years. As a result, college students who major in archaeology do not have enough opportunity to get formal training in the skills and methodology of field archaeology. As sometimes ill-educated staff of the cultural heritage institutions are in charge of the fieldwork, the quality of the excavation has declined considerably in recent years. In order to find a remedy for this important and essential problem, the Korean Association of Professors in Archaeology was formed most recently and will try to find a compromising solution which could benefit both the academic and salvage archaeology. Last year, South Korean government announced that multiple versions of government-approved textbooks of Korean history would no longer be used from 2017, and single version of Korean history textbooks edited by the National Institute of Korean History will be used for primary, middle, and high school students. Not only the general public, but also historians, archaeologists, and other specialists expressed a strong objection to this attempt to monopolize the interpretation of the past by the government. 9 scholarly associations in archaeology issued a joint statement on November 6, 2015, expressing their strong opposition to the government's plan for state-monopolized textbooks of Korean history, and their individual members' rejection of participating in writing such textbooks. However, the government has pushed ahead with the change, and the National Institute of Cultural Korean History is currently editing the textbooks at the moment. Most of the concern and fear in this issue is focused on the rewriting of the more recent past, including the colonial history, relation between the South and North Korea, and the authoritarian rule of the late President Park Chung-hee. However, some archaeologists are worried that the current conservative government would adopt a more nationalistic and subjective interpretation of early Korean history and archaeology as well. The first sign of such orientation was seen in the installation of the Old Joseon Gallery at National Museum of Korea during the government of President Lee Myung-bak. As the two most recent governments are conservative in nature, some of the nationalist scholars insist and lobby for the education of the great role of the Old Joseon in ancient Korea, especially Dangun. Some of them even deny the presence of Chinese commanderies in Korean Peninsula, though established by the Han Empire in 108 BCE. When these scholars and lobbyists criticize the funding of Harvard's Early Korea Project for the publication of a book on Chinese commanderies by National Northeast Asia History Foundation, the foundation capitulated to their pressure and discontinued its financial support for the Early Korea Project. So far, I have discussed and spent most time on the recent discoveries and controversies in South Korean archaeology. For just a minute or so, I will try to summarize what is happening in North Korea. In short, basically almost nothing since the discovery of the tomb of Dangun, and I'm sorry. This is the cover of the book published by Harvard's Early Korean Project in 2013. Since the discovery of the tomb of Dangun and his wife in the vicinity of Pyongyang in 1992, according to the official position of North Korean archaeology, a mythical and legendary common ancestor of all Koreans, Dangun, is an actual historical figure. After Dangun established the first state in the Daedong River Valley about 5,000 years ago, this so-called Daedong River civilization flourished for many millennia with the evidence of writing, bureaucracy, and bronze metallurgy. According to official position of North Korea, the archaeological remains that had been attributed to the Chinese Han commandery of Lolang are in fact those of Nangnang Kingdom, an indigenous society with close interaction with the Han Empire. It is quite a bitter irony that even with the great deal of hostilities and animosities between the two governments, the conservative South Korean government and the totalitarian North Korean government share a very similar view of the early Korean history and archaeology. That's the last statement of my presentation. And I would like to thank you very much for listening my this short summary of the recent discoveries and controversies in Korean archaeology. I also would like to thank the Harvard-Yenching Institute and the director, Professor Perry for inviting me to this annual roundtable, and thank Rowan Flood for getting me involved in this important discussion. Thank you very much.